Helping somebody find a seat. You can be seated. Thank you for coming. Welcome to Capital City Church. I don't know if you've noticed the conversations that have gone on. It's been a turbulent week after a turbulent week before that. And there's been a lot of discussion about social media this week. One of the things that I think is most dangerous about social media, and I don't know if you've ever thought about this before, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. It's dangerous because we see unrealistic expectations. We see what other people put out. I heard somebody say one time that when you see a social media feed of someone else, you're looking at their highlight reel. And you should never compare your everyday life to someone else's highlight reel. But we do. We're looking at unrealistic expectations, and it makes us feel like someone else is enough, but we aren't. And so the good news is, tonight, we're going to do what we do every week. We, together, are going to confess out loud that we're not enough, that we're not supposed to be enough. Nobody's enough. But we're not talking about nobody. We're not talking about everybody. We're talking about us, right? So let's say this together. Almighty God, we acknowledge and confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. Deepen within us our sorrow for the wrong we have done and the good we have left undone. Lord, you are full of compassion and gracious, slow to anger and abundant in mercy. There is always forgiveness with you. Time out. Stop. You believe that?
Amen.
Have you believed that this week? Did your soul know that it was true? Let's say that again. There is always forgiveness with you. Restore to us the joy of your salvation. Bind up that which is broken. Give light to our minds, strength to our wills, and rest to our souls. Speak to each of us, and let your word abide with us until it has wrought in us your holy will.
I've said this before if you've been here with us, but as we begin the service, we want to prepare our hearts. You know, we're ascending the hill to the Holy of Holies, and often we need to just take some time ourselves just to confess the things in our hearts that are between us and God. If there's somebody in the room or somebody you know that you need to confess to as well, I would encourage you to do that, because I think that entering the Holy of Holies and ascending that hill is a tall order, and when we have things that are hindering us from fully worshiping God Almighty, I don't think we have any business approaching the throne. So let's just take a moment as you prepare to sing this song. Just maybe close your eyes and just take some time for personal confession before we continue.
Through the shadows of my soul,
Church, let's lift this promise up, this declaration. Come on.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your very body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me.
Yeah.
says, huh?
It is bright up here.
I've always been impressed when people come up here to read the scripture, the passion and the emotion that I hear in their voices as they read the scripture. And that's the way it should be, I believe. It's a love letter to us from God, and people get emotional and passionate when they read a love letter. So I'm going to read out tonight out of 1 Samuel chapter 3, verses 1 through 10. Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord in the presence of Eli. And the word of the Lord was rare in those days. There was no frequent vision. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his own place. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called Samuel, and he said, "Here I am," and ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I didn't call. Lie down again." So he went and lay down. And the Lord called again, "Samuel?" And Samuel rose and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I didn't call, my son. Lie down again." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. And the Lord called Samuel again the third time. And he arose and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore Eli said to Samuel, "Go, lie down, and if he calls you, you shall say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant hears.'" So Samuel went, lay down in his place, and the Lord came and stood, calling us as at other times, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant hears." That to me should be our attitude at all times. Speak, for your servant is listening.
Father's not. Bear your cross as you wait for the crown. Tell the world of the treasure you found.
If you would remain standing with me, we're going to be reading out of the book of John, chapter 1 tonight. If you've got sermon notes, the scripture's on there. If we can get some house lights, that'd be good. Sermon notes, you may be reading a paper Bible, you may be reading it on your device. We're going to put scripture up here on the screen, so if you're not following along, it's your own fault, all right? It's in like 14 places at once. So here we go. I'm just kidding. John chapter 1, fascinating, fascinating story. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. And I know you don't have any context yet. We're going to give you that in just a second, but just hang with me. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip, and he said to him, "Follow me." Now, Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. And Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him of whom Moses and the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, what did he say? "Come and see." Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him and said of him, "Behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael said to him, "How do you know me?" Jesus answered him, "Before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you." Nathanael answered him, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered him, "Because I said to you, I saw you under the fig tree, do you believe? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Truly, truly, I say to you, you will see heaven opened, the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man." You may be seated. May God bless the reading of his word tonight. I want to welcome you. I've seen some new faces, and I've seen an awful lot of familiar faces. Many of you are aware, Capital City Church exists. Our mission is that we want to help people love Jesus and then live for him every day. We want, and that's really put in a very specific order. We want to help you love Jesus first, because Jesus loved you first. And everything starts with love. Giving your heart to Christ, following Christ, it always starts with love. In fact, I think if you go back and you read the stories of Jesus' ministry, if you look at how he went into in depth in the Sermon on the Mount, and when he calls out religious people, he calls them out. Why? Because their heart wasn't in it. Their heart wasn't in it. They were going through the motions. So we want to help you love Jesus, and then we want to help you live for him out of that love. Love him first, have a heart for him, have a passion for him, and then be obedient. Live as a disciple, grow as a follower, grow in obedience to him, but living out of that love. And we know from experience that this is the best change that anyone could ever make in their life. In fact, you and I could tell stories, couldn't we? We could get the microphone out and we could take turns, and you could come up here one at a time and just tell stories, and we would be here till this time tomorrow night or Monday night. Talking about what we've seen, what I've seen in my life, and what you've seen in your life, what it means to follow Jesus. And we don't always get it right, I know that, but man, when we do, how much fun is it? How much fun is it to follow with a full heart? How much fun is it to follow when you really are in love with Jesus and with who he is? And especially in light of the turmoil that we've seen in our culture over the last 2 weeks, and we spoke to that a little bit last week. But especially in light of this turmoil that we seem to be feeling, it feels like things are bubbling. I was reading this week, and I read Romans 15. Romans 15, 13 says this. I love this. "May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in," what's the word? Yeah. "May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing." In other words, we get joy and peace when we have faith, when we're believing, when we have faith in God. It gives us joy and it gives us peace. And coming out of that, that faith in God will let us live in hope. It'll let us live with hope. And hope is so desperately needed in our culture right now. First of all, for us to experience, and then second of all, for us to share with those around us. I don't know if you're anything like me, but when it comes to friends that I have who don't know Jesus, who aren't walking with Jesus, they wouldn't claim to be Christian, they wouldn't claim to be whatever term you want to use. I'm not a church person, I'm not a Bible person, I'm not sure about that, you know, I've heard it all, right? And by the way, I hope you have some friends like that. I hope you don't live totally in an echo chamber. Like, I hope you have some friends that are far from God. We should, right? And if you're anything like me, the friends that I have who are like that, I have some friends that I know need to change. And certainly, this is not based on me having it all together. I'm a sinner in need of grace every single day. Amen? You guys believe that I'm a sinner in need of grace every single day. It's okay. You're right. I do. But I have some friends that I know need really change, and especially over, you know, almost two decades as a pastor and interacting with people and watching people. There seems to be, you know, you see unhealthy lifestyle choices. For some people, it's not them. They have a child that's grown up and maybe grew up in the church and kind of went wayward, and now they're far from God. And so the parents, maybe they're going to church and they love God and they're committed to God, but their hearts are just, you know, broken. They have overbearing neighbors who are looking for acceptance. I don't know if you've ever had that experience. Sometimes you get those overbearing coworkers, and, you know, maybe it's a little tough to deal with them, but really people just want to be accepted. People just want to be loved for who they are. I hope you know that. I hope you figured that out. Maybe it's somebody that you know who just financially can't seem to get it together, and yeah, they don't have faith in God, but also there's some other areas of their life that kind of need to be addressed. Or maybe you know somebody that's just, they're in a rough spot right now. You know, they don't know God, but also there's turmoil in their life just because of 2020, right? Financially, vocationally, emotionally, maybe relationally or socially, they're just living with upheaval. And then it seems like you and I probably also have some friends who don't know Christ, but their life's pretty good. They don't have any turmoil. They manage their finances okay. They have great family. Maybe they have a great marriage. And yet still, you and I know that deep down, living without Jesus is living without permanent hope. Now, you can find hope here and there, right, in pockets, but like we talked about last week, you need permanent, you need eternal hope. There are people who have not been directly affected by the things that have gone over the last year, but we've still been shaken. So I want to ask you a question. If you know someone who needs a change in their life, where does change come from? Have you ever thought about it? How does change happen in someone's life? Most of us sitting in here tonight have experienced it. Kind of why we're sitting here, isn't it? We've experienced a change. What does change look like? Where does change come from? How does it happen? Well, actually, I don't know if you've ever thought about this before, but it's a really important idea. Change always starts with a catalyst. This is in your notes. Change always starts with a catalyst. It starts because something happened. All significant change is going to chase back to a catalyst, to something that happened. Maybe you got a different job. Maybe you got different friends. Maybe you got married. Maybe you got divorced. Maybe you started exercising. Maybe you quit exercising. Maybe you had kids. Listen, because this room is full of people on both ends of this spectrum. Maybe you had kids, or maybe the kids moved out. Right? I'm in the middle. Like, we've had the kids. Maybe the kids move out. These are big changes. I experienced this a couple years ago unexpectedly. Maybe you lost a parent. Didn't know that was coming. It's tough. Maybe you started going to church. Maybe you're sitting here tonight because you're not sure about the God thing, Jesus thing, Bible thing. Maybe you came because somebody offered you dinner when we're finished. Make them pay. Order the steak. What does change look like? What does this catalyst look like? I don't know if you've ever thought about it. You probably have, because if you're like me, and I think you are, you've experienced catalyst moments. You've experienced moments in your life where there was a catalyst, where something happened, and they're riveting to watch. And tonight, what I want to do, in the time that we have left together, I want to go back to these verses from the beginning of the Gospel of John, and I want us to walk back through. It's a narrative. It's a story. This is something that actually happened, and it is the relating to us of a catalyst moment for someone. So I want us to look at it, and then at the end, we're going to give you a chance to have a catalyst moment for yourself, okay? So, to set the stage, we already read this scripture. This was probably in late summer or fall, early fall of the year 26 is what I'm thinking. This was very early in Jesus' ministry. Jesus wasn't really known yet. There were, you know, a few who knew him, but nobody really knew him as the Jesus that he would, you know, become, even though he was that guy. He just didn't have that widespread reputation yet. The disciples weren't the disciples yet. In fact, he was kind of still getting them together. So this story takes place in Bethany, and it's sandwiched between Jesus, if you remember kind of the chronology of Jesus' ministry, he's baptized, and then he goes into the wilderness to be tempted, and he comes out, and he performs the first miracle, which, can anybody remember what the first miracle was? Water into wine. You are not Baptists, because you would have said water into grape juice. Come on, that was funny. So between those two, I've heard them all, man. Between those two, this story happens. He's come, he's been baptized, he's gone into the wilderness to be tempted, he's come back, and he's about to go into Cana to this wedding. So actually, what we're going to read is this story takes place in a really busy week for him. So kind of on day one of this week, there's a group of religious leaders that come from Jerusalem to interrogate John the Baptist, to find out, hey, like, are you the Messiah? Who are you, the one that we've been praying for? Are you the one that we've been looking for? That happens on the first day. The second day of the week, John the Baptist publicly points out Jesus Christ, right? He's behold the Lamb of God, right? That takes away the sins of the world. That happens. Two disciples of the Baptist the next day, which was Andrew, and we think it might have actually been John. They were disciples of John the Baptist, and they left John the Baptist, started following Jesus. The next day, Andrew brings Peter to Jesus. So then day five is where our story picks up. It says, the next day, which is day five, Jesus decided to go to Galilee, and he found Philip, who was minding his own business, right? And said to him, follow me. Can you imagine what it would have been like to get a personal invitation from Jesus? Listen, you didn't seek him. He came and found you and said, you follow me. Who was this amazing man? Not Jesus, the other guy. We know Jesus was amazing. Who is this amazing person that gets this personal invitation? He scored a direct invitation to a pretty exclusive group, wouldn't you say? I mean, there are only 12 of them. It's a pretty good deal. How do you get that? You know what's fascinating about this? He really wasn't anybody special. He really wasn't. Philip was actually just a regular guy. He wasn't outspoken and well-spoken and maybe spoke too much like Peter, right? Remember the stories of Peter? Peter always had a word, didn't he? He always had something to say. He wasn't like that. He wasn't saintly like John, who was always just this sweet, gentle person who was described as the one that Jesus loved, because he felt loved by Jesus, and he was loved by Jesus. But Philip's just a regular guy. He likely actually could have been a follower of John the Baptist before this. We don't know. A couple of times that he shows up in the narrative of Jesus' ministry. Once when Jesus was feeding the multitude. I don't know if you remember the story of when Jesus was feeding the multitude the second time. He fed the 4,000. And he said, we're not going to send them away. You give them something to eat. And you remember one of the disciples said, 200 denarii isn't enough to buy enough bread for all these people. Do you guys remember that in that story? That's our guy. Like, that's one of his claims to fame. He didn't get a whole lot of words in the Bible, but one of them is, Jesus, I'm not sure you've thought this through. He's just a regular guy. He's just a regular guy. Later on, towards the end of Jesus' ministry, as we're getting towards Passion Week, as we're getting towards Holy Week, some Greeks showed up and asked to see Jesus. If you read in John 12, you'll see this story. Some Greeks showed up and asked to see Jesus, and Philip didn't know what to do, so he kind of passed them off. I don't even know what that's about. I wish I could explain the story to you. I don't know what happened. I just know that he didn't seem to be able to connect them with Jesus. He didn't always get it right. He was just a regular guy. Philip was an ordinary person, this is in your notes, who had experienced something extraordinary. He was just an ordinary person that had experienced something extraordinary. In fact, wouldn't you say that described most of the disciples? I've said this often. I heard somebody say this years ago, and it stuck with me. If I had spent my life teaching like Jesus did, and I wanted to find 12 guys to pass everything off to because I knew that I was going back to the Father, I don't know that I would have picked these 12 guys. Aren't you glad Jesus is so much wiser than me? He knew who he needed. He knew who he needed to pick, and he chose these guys. This is the thing. When you and I think about sharing our faith with others, when we think about introducing someone else to what's possibly a catalyst moment, we usually think, well, I don't know if I'm qualified. I don't know if I can speak up. I mean, I feel like I should call up Pastor Tim and have him come and do it, right? Or I feel like I should call one of the elders, or I feel like I should call my small group leader. But you're there. You're there. Leon Morris said this. This quote is in your notes. It's encouraging to reflect that Jesus went out of his way to find this rather limited man. Isn't that great? And to enlist him in the apostolic band. That's not like a rock band. That's like the group of apostles. Some of the apostles were undoubtedly men of great ability, but Philip compels us to realize that others were perfectly ordinary people. Can I just tell you? That's how Christianity works. It's just a bunch of perfectly ordinary people who know that we're sinners, we know that we need grace, and we come on our knees and we come on our face, we ask God to forgive us, and we get so overwhelmed by it that we just go tell other people about it. Verse 44, Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael, which if you're keeping score at home, likely was Bartholomew, two names, and said to him, "We have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." And Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of North Topeka?" Can anything good come out of Nazareth? Nazareth? Are you kidding me? Can't you just hear it? When you invite that person that's far from God? Church? Are you kidding me? Read the Bible. Are you kidding me? Come to a Bible study. Have coffee to talk about Scripture, to talk about God. Are you kidding me? See, Nazareth wasn't evil. It was just insignificant. So you're telling me, it's as if he was saying, you're telling me that God sent the Savior of the world to that backwater place? Don't you love his response? Don't you love his response? As you can see on this PowerPoint presentation that I've prepared, there are at least 41 reasons why Jesus is the fulfilled Messiah. No. No. He just met the guy. I don't know. I just know what I saw. I know what I heard. See, we don't fear skeptics because we're not personally responsible to convince them. Some of you need to really internalize that. You've thought about sharing your faith. Maybe this week you had a chance to speak up to someone, listen, who needed to have a catalyst moment. You had the chance to speak up. You could have spoken up, but you didn't do it because you're worried they're going to be a skeptic. Could I just let all the tension out of the balloon for you? They are. It's okay. It's not your job to convince anyone of anything. Look at me. You're not that powerful. And you're not smart enough. I love you. I'm not smart enough. Aren't you glad that God's still in the convincing business? That's what he does. He draws people. See, our job's just to put the seed out there. God takes care of what happens. It's a lot like growing a garden at your house, isn't it? You just plant the seed and you do your part and just, I don't know, it's a miracle. Something happens. Because God's always at work. He's always at work. I love in John 9, I gotta move through this. Like I could do a whole thing on John 9. This story, remember the guy that was born blind? And Jesus comes and heals him. And he spits and he makes clay and he puts the mud on his eyes. And he says, go wash. And then Jesus kept walking. I don't know if you ever thought about this in that story. The guy had not seen Jesus. He went and he washed and he came back. I love it. This is so good. He says he came back seeing. This guy was in his 40s and he had been blind since birth. You think that was a catalyst moment? So do you remember all these religious, the religious leaders who are just nasty people? They corner him and they try to interrogate him about Jesus. And he's like, I don't know. I don't know what he looks like. Listen, they say, admit to it, confess to it. He's a sinner. This is what he says. Listen, whether he is sinner, I do not know. Listen, I didn't have that much time interacting with him. I don't know the whole story. Here's what one thing I do know, though I was blind. Now I see. Listen, if you go back and read the story, it shut them up. You know how hard it is to make a religious person shut up? Holy goodness, are you kidding me? Wow. You can't argue with that. He had been blind since birth and now he can see. I don't, like, you're asking me questions that I can't answer. I don't know how to answer those questions, so I'm just going to steer it back to what I do know how to answer, which is what my catalyst moment was. So we keep going. Philip said to him, come and see. Here's what I've experienced and what I know. I can't answer all of your questions. So come and check it out for yourself and draw your own conclusions. Listen, this is so fascinating. Actually, this formula, this come and see formula, was used by rabbis to show, listen to this, that a solution to a particular problem was possible and it should be sought together. So it's almost as if we're saying, you know what, Rick, that is a great question. Come with me. Let's go see if we can get an answer to that question. I'll go with you. Isn't that great? Come and see. I'm going. You want to walk with me? Come see this. How many times do we pray? God, give them peace. God, send them peace. God, send them comfort. God, send them wisdom. God, send them an angel. And I think maybe sometimes God's response is, I sent them you. I sent them you. And I want you to speak up. Please hear this. I know if you're wired to be a peacemaker, this makes you all squirrely inside. Because the point of a catalyst moment is that you create tension. I know if you want to be a peacemaker, the best thing you can do is say nothing. To not speak up. That's not what we're called to do. That's not what we're called to do. And it may create some tension, but if you do it with love for them, and if they know that you'll... By the way, can I tell you this? This is not part of my sermon, so turn off your watch for a second. Listen, do you know what's the best way to convince somebody that you love them? It's to just love them. They'll figure it out. Don't try to convince them that you care about them. Just care about them as much as you know how. They'll figure it out. And along the way, they may have a catalyst moment, and it may be difficult. There may be some tension there. That's when God works the most. Verse 47, Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, and he said of him, "Behold, an Israelite indeed," say it with me, "in whom there is no deceit." In other words, he's not a pretender. This word that's translated "no deceit," if you back up in classical Greek, you find that this was a word that was used for bait when you were fishing. There's no deception. There's no double agenda. Jesus saluted Nathanael as a straightforward person. It's in your notes. We're called to be authentic because Jesus values authenticity. You ever thought about that? Jesus values authenticity. Jesus values honesty. Jesus values it when we're not pretending. Hey, listen. This is why, towards the beginning of every service, every week, I walk up here and I make you say out loud that you're a sinner. This is why we have a confession every week, because we want to pose all week long and we want to pretend that we've got it all together. Don't bring that in here. You want to experience God? You need to be authentic. Could you hear this? You want those around you to experience God through you? Then you need to be authentic. Sometimes I think the worst thing that we can do is pretend like we have it all together. I gave you this quote last week. Martin Luther said, "May a merciful God preserve me from a Christian church in which everyone is a saint." Isn't that great? I don't want to go to a church of saints. I won't fit in. I want to be and remain in the church and little flock of the faint-hearted, the feeble, and the ailing, who believe in the forgiveness of sin. That's where I want to be. I want to be where the sinners are finding grace. You know why? Because I'm a sinner. And I'm tired of pretending that I'm not. Verse 48, Nathanael said to him, "How do you know me? You act like you recognize me." Jesus answered him, "Before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you." Now, are you ready for this? You ready for this deep seminary explanation? I don't know what that means. I can't tell you what he means. I don't know what it means to be under the fig tree. I could guess, but there's no explanation. There's no reference to anything. But apparently it meant something, right? Because Nathanael, that you're about to see, this changed everything for Nathanael. When Jesus said that, the point is Jesus' knowledge. It's not what Nathanael was doing or what this meant or what the imagery was or what it stood for. The point is that Jesus saw him before he should have been seeable. Jesus saw him. Oh, man. You know that friend that you have, that coworker, that neighbor, that family member that's far from God that you've probably already been thinking about? That person that needs to have that catalyst moment, did you know that right now, God sees them? Right now, God sees them. He knows what they're doing. He knows things about them that you and I don't know. God sees them. He knows their lives. He knows their hopes. He knows their dreams. He knows their fears and failures already. Please look at me. And he's just itching for a chance to intersect with them. And he might have sent you. Was this a catalyst moment? Well, I want you to notice how quickly Nathanael changes here. Because remember, at first it was, is it possible for anything good to come out of Nazareth? And he's walking up and Jesus says this to him and he's like, how do you even know who I am? And when Jesus says this, this is his response. Verse 49, Nathanael answered him, "Rabbi, you're the Son of God. You're the King of Israel." Very interesting. He did not address Jesus as rabbi until he saw his power. He didn't address him as rabbi right away. It wasn't until he saw his power. And by the way, very interesting, I don't know if you ever thought about this, Jesus just said, behold, an Israelite in whom there is no guile, there is no deceit. And Nathanael's response now is, you're the king of Israel. How cool is that? Hey, if I'm an Israelite, you're the king of Israel. You're my king. You're my king. You are the king of Israel. And by the way, I told you this is very early in Jesus' ministry. This same title would be used at the beginning of his ministry here and at the end of his ministry when he was being mocked. The king of Israel. Verse 50, Jesus answered, because I said to you, I saw you under the fig tree, do you believe? You will see greater things than these. Verse 51, I want you to read it with me. And he said to him, truly, truly, I say to, okay, you, listen, hang on. See, in the English, we don't really have a way to differentiate when I say you, if I'm talking to you, or all of you. It's a singular or a plural. Well, actually, if you go to the South, we did, it was called y'all. In fact, it was y'all and all y'all. That's the plural, right? Listen, Jesus just switched on us. You, singular, will see greater things than these. And he said to him, truly, truly, I say to all y'all, all of you. He went plural. He went big. Why? Because he wasn't only talking to Nathanael anymore. Truly, truly, I say to all of you, you will see heaven opened. In other words, you're going to see divine things. You know how the story ended. Did they see some divine things? Oh, man. Oh, man. Starting with the water turned into grape juice, right? And then it just kept going. Miracle after miracle after miracle, and walking on water and people being raised from the dead. Jesus knew what he was talking about. You're going to see greater things than these. You're going to see heaven open. You're going to see divine. You're going to see miraculous. You're going to see big things. And the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man. Oh, this is so good. You know what Jesus was saying to them? You're joining a plural story. You're joining a story that's bigger than you. And you have no idea the journey I'm going to take you on. If you've been walking with Jesus for any length of time, isn't that true? Like if I could hop you in my DeLorean time machine and take you back in the past, and you and I could get out and we could talk to you back then when you first gave your heart to Christ. Wouldn't you say that? Isn't that one of the things that you would say to you then? You have no idea the journey you're about to go on. You have no idea the things you're about to see. But you know what? You'll never be the same. That's what Jesus is saying to these guys. It's what he's saying to them. And it wasn't just the 12 of them. It was all who would believe because of their testimony. And it was him, and it was her, and it was you, and it was all of us. He's going to take us on this grand journey. And we're never going to be the same because of what we see, because of what we hear, because of what we experience. And for the rest of our days, we're going to look back on that moment when we gave our heart to Christ. We're going to look back on that moment as the pivotal moment in our lives. That was the catalyst moment. And for many of us, there was pain and there was difficulty leading into that. But we needed that because we had to have a catalyst moment. And I don't know how your story goes, but for me, it started with an invitation. An invitation to the gospel. I love this. Colossians 1, 13 to 14 says that he has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved son. You talk about a great gospel message. in whom we have redemption. We've been bought back. We have the forgiveness of sins. He's delivered us. This is a liberating term. He came in and got us. He rescued us. We were in the wrong domain. We were in the wrong realm. We were in the realm of sin and darkness and pain and difficulty. And God came after us like a Navy SEAL that you've never seen. He was on a mission. He was coming after you. He delivered us from the domain of darkness, and he transferred us. The imagery here, please hear this, is so good. The imagery here is when the Israelites left Egypt. They were going to a new kingdom. And guess what? The people in the old kingdom didn't like it, and God didn't care. He just does what he wants to do. He came and got you, and all the forces of hell fought against him, and it wasn't even a fair fight. He just got you anyway. And he brought you into his kingdom. What a catalyst moment. How energizing is that for you and me as we walk out of here and we have friends and we have family members, we have neighbors and we have coworkers who also need to have a catalyst moment. And God sent us. We're ordinary. Well, so were these guys. Sin and darkness had its grip on you. And King Jesus walked in and he took you for his own. That is our experience. And that's the journey we're inviting other people to. So by this point, I would imagine that for many of you, you've had a face in the back of your mind while I've been talking. I would imagine that somebody's name has come to mind. You've thought about somebody. So here's what I want you to do. You had one of these on your seat, probably, or else there was one close by. I hope you didn't crumple it up and throw it at somebody. It says, who's your one? It's got some of the verses that we read tonight. The one is one person that you feel especially burdened for. Who's that person that's in your realm of influence that God perfectly positioned you to speak to? Who's that one person? I probably don't know them. I don't need to know them. But in just a minute, we're going to pray. We're going to sing. We're going to have a baptism. It's going to be fun. But I would invite you to be brave. And write that person's first name only. I don't need to know who they are, but I want you to write their name on this card. And at the end of the service, I'll tell you what to do with this card, but you're going to turn it in, and I'm going to get it, and the elders and I are going to start praying for all of these ones. We can pray for them by name if you give us their name. And we're going to pray over them every week. And at some point in the future, because it won't be that long till Easter. And Easter's a great time to invite people to church. It's a great time to share your faith. Right now, with all the turmoil that's going on in our culture, it's a great time to share your faith. And I want you to look at me. For many of you, writing a name on this card will be a catalyst moment. This will be the start for you of taking action on what you know that God's been calling you to do. Let's pray. God, thank you for your grace. Thank you for the gospel. Thank you that you came after us when we did not deserve it. Like I told somebody this week, I'm yours because you ran faster than me, God. I was running away from you as fast as I could, and you just came and got me because you're a good God. You're a loving God. You're a perfect heavenly Father. So we thank you for grace. We thank you for the gospel. Thank you that you've called us not just to live in that grace and experience that grace and to celebrate that grace, but also to share it. We want to share it with those around us, especially those people that we know are ready to have a catalyst moment. God, I trust your spirit to do the work. I don't know what else to say, so I'm just going to be quiet. But you know every person sitting here right now, and you know who they're interacting with, and I just trust that your spirit's going to put somebody on their heart, and that you're going to help us do our part to cooperate with you in the great big work that you're doing, which is writing a great big story of your redemption, your amazing grace. How incredible that we get to be a part of that. It is a blessing from your hand. We don't deserve it, and yet we are so, so thankful for it. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for the cross. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. Well, we have some intruders in here. We are going to baptize a second grader. How fun is this? So, play the video, guys.
Would you like to confess Jesus?
Yes, I do. Yes, I do. I declare that Jesus is my Lord and Savior.
Okay. Upon your profession of faith, it is with great joy I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Here you go.
I don't know about all y'all, but that makes me excited. Makes you really excited. Would you guys stand up with us and sing one last song before we close out our night? We sang this song last week. And if you remember it, sing nice and loud. And if you didn't remember it, sing nice and loud.
Your goodness, I would be desperate without your love, slave to the darkness. If it wasn't for the cross, you have won me with your kindness, chase me down. I was lost. Where would I be if it wasn't for the cross?
Sing it out.
Well, anyway. Thanks for coming. I'm about to take it off anyway. I don't know if you noticed in your bulletin, the first thing in there says that we have some volunteer t-shirts. So if you're volunteering anywhere here at Cap City, we just wanted to say thank you. So we're giving you a free t-shirt. We hope you'll wear it, or if not, maybe you can wash your car with it or something. I don't know. But either way, there's a table at the back, right back here. So go back and grab a t-shirt. And sort of just one way that we'd like to say thank you. If you want to pray with somebody, Tom and Susan Bryan, Tom's one of our elders. He's going to be right over here. If you want to pray, ask questions, whatever the case may be, they're going to be right down front here. Really are glad that you came. Our benediction this week, last night just praying and just thinking about Psalm 139, right? I pray this week you'd remember that there is nowhere that you can go where you're going to be away from God's Spirit. There's nowhere that you can go where you're going to be away from His presence. If we ascend to heaven, He is there. If we make our bed in hell, He's there. If we feel the darkness covering us and the light about us fading, may we remember that darkness is not dark to Him. The night is as bright as the day to Him, for darkness and light both bow before Him. You will never be beyond His reach. You'll never be beyond His grace. You'll never be away from His presence. Go in peace. You're dismissed.